So this numerical will be brought somewhere here so that we will do our calculation now. Right? So let us now open our calculators and let us apply the same process that we have learnt earlier on. First we should sum up the given data. Always a numerical should start with given data. So let us list out what is the given data. R134A is the refrigerant. Okay. Second thing is it is vapor compression cycle. It is not specified as ideal vapor compression cycle. It is a vapor compression cycle only. There is no word called ideal. That you should note. Third is the evaporator pressure is 200 kPa. The condenser pressure is 1400 kPa. So you can straight away write pressure high is equals to 1400 kPa. Pressure low in the circuit is specified as 200 kPa. Isentropic efficiency of the compressor is specified. So efficiency of the compressor is specified as 88%. So this is 0.88. We have seen earlier in the steam calculations or the Rankine cycle calculations, we understand what is the meaning of compressor efficiency, isentropic or isentropic efficiency of the turbine. So I am not repeating that part again, but we will show it in the calculation. The mass flow rate is specified. Mass flow rate of a refrigerant is specified as 0.025 kg per second. Now there is more data that is listed, so let us write it down everything. The refrigerant enters the compressor at a rate we have given, mentioned, superheated by 10.1 degree centigrade. What is that it is given? Super heat, degrees of superheat. It is given as 10.1 degree centigrade. And leaves the condenser subcooled by 4.4 degree centigrade. That meaning subcooling is mentioned as 4.4 degree centigrade. Now determine the rate of cooling provided by the evaporator. So that means we have to say to calculate what is expected from us. What is that we need to calculate? Rate of cooling provided by the evaporator. What does that mean? It means QL, Q dot L that we have been discussing all the while. Cooling provided by the evaporator, the power input means work in, and COP. Okay, in two conditions. One is the first one it is being requested is for a vapor compression cycle, and second they are asking to do the computation for a ideal. So I would call it real compute and ideal cycle, real cycle and ideal cycle. Now if you look at, there is nothing much provided other than this data. So from this data you can understand that the expected real refrigerator cycle we should look for is this shape. There is no pressure loss. We can take that the pressure is constant between the state 2 and 3, that is between state 2, that is exit of the compressor to the inlet of expansion valve. There is no pressure loss. They have ruled out. This is some, with some idealization. Okay. And even in the low pressure circuit also there is no pressure loss, or it has been neglected, that's too small to be considering for in our calculation. So you should remember that we are working with such a cycle. So the next aspect for you is to draw the cycle how you wanted to do it. So either you can draw a pH diagram or you can draw a TS diagram to describe the process. Okay, so let us draw this vapor dome. So this is T, this is specific entropy. So we are saying low pressure line. So we are told that suction of the compressor is at here with certain degree of superheat, and the high pressure line is also specified. It's constant more or less, and isentropic efficiency is specified as 0.88. So from that you can understand that it is not a straight line, but it deviates, because the efficiency is specified, so it is deviating. It is deviating in a way that it intersects this high pressure line somewhere here. The straight line would be somewhere here. It is, since it is mentioned 0.88, I have taken only a slight deviation from it. So this is two state. This is state 1, this is state 2. From here it has come down, and it has come down to 3. Here it is mentioned subcooling. So from here it is expanding to state 4, which we can plot here. And if you look at carefully the specified data, the degree of superheat which is said is something like this. If you draw a line at state 1 and Tsat at low pressure, this is Tsat, temperature saturation at PL in our circuit. This is T1. So T1 minus T saturation at PL is given as degrees of super heat, 10.1 degrees centigrade. And what is specified for the degree of subcooling? That is, I would draw similarly the line here. This is T sat, temperature saturation at pressure high. This is T3. Okay, this is T3. So what is given? T sat at P high, pressure high, minus T3 is given as 4.4 degrees centigrade. This is the degree of superheat. Okay, this is degree of superheat. And this is degree of subcooling, or simply subcooling. So before attempting to solve, you have to do this little bit of exercise. Okay, now how to solve this numerical? I would solve for a real cycle, and I expect the students to watch the process and repeat it for the ideal cycle, because the ideal cycle would be much simpler. Okay, so let us pull out our property tables. Now if you look at the saturated refrigerant tables, There are two classes of saturated refrigerant tables. One is temperature table and the other is pressure table. We should understand which is beneficial for our case. Now if you look at, we are given pressure high and pressure low. So since the data specified is talking in terms of pressure, it makes simpler to use saturated refrigerant pressure table, not the temperature table, because we are dealing with pressure. And if you look at the, what is the pressure specified, 1400 kPa and 200 kPa. 1400 kPa and 200 kPa. See, if you look at 200 kPa is here and 1400 kPa is also here. So it makes the calculations much simpler. Okay, so let us read now the data. So we have to calculate Q dot L. Now list out your priority, something like this. You are being asked to calculate what is Q dot L. You know it is the difference between H1 and H4. Multiplied by m dot, and you are asked to calculate work in. Work in, you know, it is between H2 and H1. M dot H2 minus H1. Okay. If you look at the table exactly, I would introduce another point here. I would call it as 2S to mean that 1 to 2S is isentropic. Clear? But realistically it will go to 2. So this will permit us to calculate, because we know from our earlier understanding that isentropic efficiency of a compressor is given, if you look at the nomenclature from here, we can write isentropic efficiency of the compressor is equals to H2S minus H1 by H2 minus H1. Watch very carefully, it is H2S minus H1 by H2 minus H1. This is given as 0.88. So this will permit us to calculate H2, because if you look at now the calculation of say H2, we can write H2 is equals to, okay, or you may, since you want the difference actually, that is H2 minus H1 rather, so that makes our life more easy. H2 minus H1 you want, so which will be H2S minus H1 by 0.88. we will calculate this isentropic say enthalpy difference, and we will divide it by 0.88 to get the work in fact for the calculation. So we can directly use now this is equals to, work in is equals to m dot, what we have said is H2S minus H1 divided by 0.88. Now the COPR coefficient of performance for this refrigerator, it is desired by required so it can be written as H1 minus H4 times 0.88 divided by H2S minus H1. Now the problem is very simple. Now all we have to do is to read the values from the tables. So if you look at very carefully, state 4, we have to take it as 4, that is specific enthalpy at 4 is equals to specific enthalpy at 3. Okay, but state 3 is in subcooled region. So how to determine its specific enthalpy? If you look at state 3, it is not saturated liquid. We cannot put it here, right? So how to find 3 is something like this. If you look at the temperature T3, if we extend the temperature line, it would reach something like this. It will intersect the saturated liquid line here. We can take H3 is roughly equal to HF at temperature T3. Please note this approximation. Okay, this is how we will have to be carefully marking the state 3, because 3 is in a liquid region. So you cannot obtain it from saturated tables, but what we are approximating is, we are approximating the specific enthalpy at state 3 to be equal to the saturated liquid specific enthalpy at temperature T3. As we are saying that why this conclusion has come is because some are fundamental thermodynamic concepts. We have understood that internal energy and enthalpy are functions of temperature only. Okay? We have noted this particular thing, right? We have said that internal energy and enthalpy are functions of temperature only. So we are using that interpretation and arriving at this equality, how to locate state 3, because you cannot find, because you cannot find a saturated you cannot find a compressed liquid tables, because what you have with you are saturated pressure tables and superheated tables only. If you scroll further down, you would only see that there are superheated refrigerant tables. There are no tables provided for the subcooled region or the compressed liquid region. So remember this approximation. So we will write H3 is equals to saturated liquid specific enthalpy at T3. Please note this point. Also, the specific enthalpy at 1, we can obtain it from superheated tables because they are provided. So H1 is superheated, will be calculated from, will be calculated from superheated tables. Tables, and which table to look for? You know the pressure. Pressure is equals to P low. Temperature at which you have to look for is equals to T sat at PL plus what is the degree of superheat? Your 10.1 degree centigrade. So this is the temperature corresponding to which you would be looking at. So how to proceed now? So we have listed the steps in our calculation. The first one to determine is specific enthalpy at 3, right? Because that will be equals to enthalpy 4. So first we are trying to determine, say, H4, and then we will determine H1. So our calculation will now begin. Now if you look at T3, it is what it is given. It is given as Tsat at pH. Tsat at pH minus 4.4 degree centigrade. So let us now look at what this thing is all about. So which table are we pulling out? We are pulling out saturated refrigerant tables for R134a, and we have to look at pressure table, not temperature table. So pressure table. So we have to look at what is the high pressure. High pressure is 1400 kPa, right? Pressure high is 1400 kPa. So 1400 kPa, if you look at this table, saturated table is in this column. Okay, so let us see. At 1400 kPa, temperature saturation is 54.4 degree centigrade, 52.4. So this is 52.4 degree centigrade minus 4.4 degree centigrade. So this will be equal to 48 degree centigrade. Clear? T3. Now similarly, we have to calculate T1 also. T1 we have said is Tsat at pressure low plus 10.1 degree centigrade. That is equals to pressure low. What is the pressure low given? 200 kPa. 200 kPa is here. 200 kPa corresponds to minus 10.09 degree centigrade. Minus 10.9 degree centigrade, and we have elevated by 10.1 degree centigrade. So it is equals to minus 0.8 degree centigrade. So from here, what we will calculate? We will calculate H3 now. H3 is equals to HF at 48 degree centigrade. That is equals to, now open our table. Now we will move to saturated pressure table to saturated temperature table. And what is the temperature we are looking at? We are looking at 48 degree centigrade. So 48 degree centigrade. Corresponding to 48 degree centigrade, he is here. The HF value is located in this column here. HF is 120.39. So 120.39, and what are the units in that particular table which are being used? Kilojoule per kg. So we will write kilojoule per kg. Now this is equals to H4 because it is throttling process between 3 and 4, isenthalpic process. So that is the reason why we are saying H3 is equals to H4. Now from here what we are going to work out? We are going to work out H1. H1 we have to refer to what pressure? We have to refer to a pressure PL 200 kPa and minus 0.8 degree centigrade. So let us look into the superheated tables. Superheated tables are something like this. We are looking at 200 kPa. If you look at the tables are provided in MPa. So first we have to convert our pressure to MPa. So PL is equals 200 kPa. That means how many MPa? This is equals to 0.2 MPa. Megapascal is 10 power 6. This is 10 cube. So it is 0.2. So we have to look at 0.2 MPa table. So where is 0.2 MPa table? Are we provided with 0.2? Yes, we are provided with 0.2. And if you look at what is the temperature we are looking at? We are looking at temperature minus 0.8 degree centigrade. Minus 0.8 is between minus 10 and 0. So in this table, what is the enthalpy is in the third column, right? Here, in this third column, enthalpy is there. So we will move to that enthalpy here. Corresponding to minus 10 at 0.2 MPa, this is the specific enthalpy, and at 0 degrees, this is the enthalpy. So we have to interpret between these two values for minus 0.8. So let us do this one. So we cannot straight away calculate. Let us for the time being keep it pending. What we know is between minus 10. So I will write two columns, something like this: temperature, enthalpy. Okay, specific enthalpy, that is minus 10 and 244.54. Minus 10 and 244.54. For value of minus 0.8, we have to calculate. What we know is for 0 degree centigrade, which is 253.05. Okay, 253.05 specific enthalpy. This is the superheated refrigerant table corresponding to pressure 0.2 MPa. So how to interpret? Use linear interpretation. What does that mean? So 0.8, minus 0.8 is very close to 0. So you can say, you can subtract from the 0 specific enthalpy, then specific enthalpy at 0 degree centigrade, or you can add. So let us linearly interpret now. We will write something like this: 253.05 we have corresponding to 0, and 244.54 corresponding to minus 10. So a simple subtraction would lead us something like this. Okay. 8.51 difference in enthalpy for a temperature difference of -10. It is an increase for this much change in temperature. So how much is for 0.8? So what we have to do is 8.51 divided by 10 for 10 degrees, and for 0.8 it would vary by this amount. This one you can either subtract it from 253.05. Okay. I hope it is being understood. So let us do this computation. Let us pull our calculator. Make sure that we enter the correct values. Now 8.51 star 0.8 divided by 10 is 0.6808. 0.6808. So this is 0.6808. So you can now do the subtraction, 253.05 minus 0.6808. So it is 252.3692. So corresponding to this value, the final value which we got from our calculator is 252.37. We can leave it at two decimal places, kilojoule per kg. So we can do we have arrived at this point. Say we will cancel this one. Now we can input our value, which is evaluated. It is 252.37 kilojoule per kg. This is what we have finally calculated. So this is H1. So we are now done with our thermodynamic calculations properties. So we have to just do a simple arithmetic to get our answers now. So QL, I would draw here and I will calculate here itself. Q dot L is now equal to H1 minus H4. So it is 252.37 kilojoule per kg minus the H4 which we have calculated here. It is minus 120.39. So this is the delta H. This multiplied by m dot would be our QL. M dot is given as mass flow rate is given as 0.25 kg per second. So 0.25. So let us quickly do our calculation. 131.08 multiplied by 0.025, which is 3.277 kilowatt. because this is in kilojoule per kg and the mass flow rate is in kg per second, so you are getting directly kilowatt. This is first thing is solved. Second thing to solve is work in is equals to m dot multiplied by H2 minus H1, which we have written it in an way H2S, that is isentrope minus H1. H1 is what we know already. Okay, we do not know H2S. So how to arrive at H2S? We have to now look at the same table. We have to, at state 1, we have to establish the entropy. It is minus 0.8 corresponding to what is the specific entropy we have to arrive at. And with that specific entropy, we have to check on the pressure corresponding to the high pressure line, which is 1400 kPa. Okay, so for that reason, we will use a calculation similar to what we have done it in this table of form. We have to work out, say I will work out here. So this is for calculating H2S. So again, T and specific entropy, I will write it. So minus 10 we do not have at minus 0.8, and we have at 0 values. Clear? So let us look at our chart. So this is the value corresponding to minus 10 degree centigrade of specific entropy, kilojoule per kg Kelvin, 0.9380. 0.9380. It's in degree centigrade, this is in kilojoule per kg Kelvin. We do not know minus 0.8. We have to calculate by linear interpretation. At 0 degree centigrade, we are given 0.9698. 0.9698. So it is by linear interpretation how to calculate 0.9698 minus 0.9380 81300. This is for a temperature change of minus 10. For 0.8, it is this much, minus 0.8, minus minus this one goes off. So this will be equals to 100, this is equals to 0.002544, right? So we will subtract this fraction from 0.9698. 0.9698 minus 0.0025. The rest becomes insignificant. 44 we are not going to bring it in picture. So the difference is 3, 7, 9. So we are now sure of this value. This is 0.0025. 9673. This is the entropy, specific entropy at state 1. So what is that we are trying to look at? We are trying to look at the isentropic process here. We are looking at the isentropic. We are saying that S1 is equals to S2S. So we will locate this point on the high pressure line and we will calculate its, correspondingly we will calculate its H2S. And that difference will be divided by the isentropic efficiency of the compressor to reach the value of H2. This is the step we are executing now. So entropy at 1 is equals to entropy at 2S, specific entropies we are trying to look at. The specific entropy at 200 kPa is 0.9673. So we have to look for this specific entropy at what pressure? We have to look at for at 1400 kPa. We have to look for specific entropy is equal to 0.9673. This is what we have to look. So let us go to the 1400 kPa. This is in the superheated region, we know for sure. So we will use superheated tables. And 1400 kPa, we know it is equals to 1.4 megapascal. So 1.4 megapascal. If you look at 1.4 megapascal is here. And what is that we are trying to achieve? So I hope the students are able to follow this one. We are referring to the same table A13 superheated R134A continued for high, say superheated region. We are going to our pressure high where we are going to look for the specific entropy now. The specific entropy is 0.9673. 0.9673, where can you interpret? You can interpret somewhere between these two values. If you look at, okay, we are not interested in the temperature aspect, but we are interested in somewhere in between identifying the specific enthalpy. Specific enthalpy is column 3. So between column 3 and column 4, we will start writing it again. So we are having 0.9733, we are having a specific enthalpy, and 0.9389, we are having a specific enthalpy. So in between we have to interpret now. So let us make our table, quick table. So on one side we are writing specific entropy, on the other side specific enthalpy now. We have to look for a value above and one below. Our specific entropy is 0.9673. The one above is 0.9673 is 9733. 9733 and it is 297. And it is 297. 0.1, and the one below 9673 is 9389, 0.9389, and its specific enthalpy is 285.47. H2 85.47. so we want this. This is H2S. So linear interpretation, as our rule goes, so 297.10 minus 285.45 subtract, we are going to get there is a difference between these two specific enthalpies, about 11.65. So we have to check now what is the range in specific entropies, so that we will divide and linearly interpret. So what is the difference between these two specific entropies? 9733 minus 0.9389. So we will have 4 here, 4 there, 3 and 0 and 0. So we have, for a difference in specific entropies of 0.0344, we have a specific enthalpy difference of 11.65. So now what we have to do is, we have to check the difference between these two or these two, and then correspondingly change either one of them. So we can either choose from the bottom level or from the higher level. So let us take it from the 0.9389 levels, or we can take it from the higher, because we notice that 0.9673 is closer to 0.9733. So it is better to interpret close to that, so that we will land up somewhere near this value, and we can even be sure that the calculation is correct. So 0.9733 minus 0.9673. 0, 6, 0, 0 and 0. So the difference between specific entropies here in this range is this. For the complete range, it is this much. So linear interpretation will give H2S is equals to 297.10 minus 11.65 by 0.0344 multiplied by 0.006. So let us pull out our calculator. 11.65 multiplied by 0.006 divided by 0.0344. It is about 2.032. So H2S will be equals to 297.10 minus 2.032. We can leave it at that level. So 2.03. So this will be 7, 0, then 5 and 9, 2. So this is what we were expecting, something very close to 297. So this is the kind of approach that you should be using in your exams also. Once you notice that this is in proximity to 9673, is in proximity to 9733, you should also correspondingly get it closer to this value. So that will build up our confidence. So H2S is non-specific enthalpy at that region. So our work can be calculated using our formula now. Work in was given as this particular thing. Let me highlight it. I'll be using the red color. I'm circling. This is what our formula would be. So I'll be using the same thing here. 295.07. So 295.07 is my H2S. And what was by H1 value? It was earlier calculated 252.37. So 252.37 minus. So this is the numerator, or let me put it at the side. Only why to leave it 3.07 minus 252.37 divided by 0.88. So we can quickly calculate what this would be. So it is 295.07 minus 252.37, 42.7. So 42.7 multiplied by what is the mass flow rate that we have noted? Mass flow rate is 0.025 kg per second multiplied by 0.025 kg per second, that divided by 0.88. So it is work in to the compressor is about 1.213 kilowatt. So now our COP can be calculated. The third part, COP for the real refrigerator cycle is equals to the desired refrigerating load 3277 kilowatt, work in is 1.213. So this will give divided by 1.213. So this is equals to 2.70 is the say coefficient of performance for this refrigerator. So this is how you have to solve. Further, whenever you perform such a calculation, I would recommend you to cross-check for your own confidence what would be the COP for, say, for a Carnot cycle that is working between PL and PH, so that you will have some yardstick to check your how much you are complying with the say the authentic evidence on the earth. Your COPR for any refrigerator cannot exceed that of a Carnot. That is what we know. For that, we know the formula. What we can use? We can use 1 upon by TH by TL minus 1. We know the TH. TH is 48 degrees, so we have to write it in terms of our say Kelvin scale. So TH is 40. So since we are using between these two pressures, the saturation pressure at pH is 52.4 degrees centigrade. So let us choose that 52.4 plus 273.15 divided by what is the TL? TL is minus 10.9 corresponding to saturation pressure at low. So minus 10.9 plus 273.15 minus 1. So let us quickly calculate the COP for an hypothetical Carnot cycle operating between those two pressures. So in the numerator we have 52.4 plus 273.15, which is 325.55. So that is equals to 1 by 325.55 divided by 273.15 minus 10.9. This is 262.25. So 262.25 minus 1. Right, so 325.55 divided by 262.25, this minus 1 is 0.2413. So 1 divided by 0.2413. So Carnot refrigerator can yield a COP of 4.14 as evidenced from our calculation, right? So that tells us that our calculation is more or less, right, is more or less accurate. So this is how you can say cross check your calculations in an examination, and that will give you some confidence because you are not exceeding Carnot COPR. It is likely that this would be correct. This is something, a check which you can always perform. But anyway, this question doesn't need this kind of working, but anyway, we are doing it for just a learning sake. So this would also give you a practice of how to calculate COP for a Carnot if it is operating between the pressure low and pressure high. So we just need to take the saturation temperatures there, and we in the absolute thermodynamic scale, and take it. So I hope the students can now understand how to solve such numericals with related to real vapor cycles. So I advise students to repeat the problem using ideal vapor cycle, which would be much more simpler than what we have done now, right? The same numerical may be recomputed for an ideal cycle, and please compare the results. Okay, I hope this gives some clarity on how to solve these numericals.